بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن ولا وبعد. Again, إخوان, we listen to the قراءة of a surah that is عظيمة جدا, from the tremendous surah and the greatest of the surah of the Quran, يعني the largest of the surah of the Quran, surah An-Nisa. And within it, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions a number of ahkam, and it is named Surah An-Nisa, la shak, because of the fact that there are numerous ahkam and rulings present within it related to the Nisa, related to the women. And that has in it one of the clearest indications, ikhwan, of the kadhib and of the falsehood of those who claim that Islam subjugates the women. Where in any other religious book do we have surah named after women? Where do we have a Surah Maryam in another one of the books that were revealed? Where do we have Surah An-Nisa in another one of the books that were revealed? The surah that specifies a mention of ahkam and rulings related to women. And within this surah, Allah Azza wa Jal gave women rights that the suffragette movement had to fight for just the turn of the century, or up to 100 or so years ago. In France and around Europe, those various movements for women's rights just recently received the rights that Allah Azza wa Jal granted to the woman in the Quran. Rights related to inheritance and other than that. Ahkam, ikhwan, and rulings that Allah Azza wa Jal blessed the woman with over 1400 years ago. And so the surah, ikhwan, it is filled with khair and filled with admonition, alongside the ahkam and the rulings that are present within it. And within it we have dalalat and dala'il, indications of the nubuwah and the prophethood of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have the likes of the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal as occurred throughout the Quran. We have surah, ikhwan, and ayat that indicate clearly the prophethood of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The likes of the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, wherein Allah Azza wa Jal mentions either, or when Allah wishes to guide an individual, that he yashrah sadrahu lil Islam. وَمَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ أَنْ يَهْدِيَهُ يَشْرَحْ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ. Whosoever Allah wishes to guide, then he expands his chest to Islam. And whosoever Allah wills to misguide, يَجْعَلْ صَدْرَهُ ضَيِّكًا حَرَجًا كَأَنَّمَا يَصَعَدُ فِي السَّمَاءِ. As though, yani, whoever Allah wishes to misguide, he makes his chest tight and restricted as though he is ascending into the sky. And again, ikhwan, that, as we've mentioned previously, is a clear indication that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did nothing but convey. How was Muhammad to know that if you ascend into the skies, it becomes difficult to breathe? And that without doubt is a dalil from the dala'il al-nubuwa. And another verse that we heard tonight, the likes of the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, كُلَّمَا نَضِجَتْ جُلُودَهُمْ بَدَّلْنَاهُمْ جُلُودًا غَيْرَهَا لِيَذُوقُ الْعَذَابِ. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions every time their skins are removed, referring to the people of the hellfire, from the nature in which Allah Azza wa Jal punishes them, Allah mentions كُلَّمَا نَضِجَتْ جُلُودَهُمْ. Every time their skins are burnt and removed, we replace them with fresh skin. لِيَذُوقُ الْعَذَابِ. That they may feel and taste the punishment. And again, ikhwan, we have in that a dalil from the dala'il al-nubuwa, since the pain, ikhwan, and the pain that a person feels on his outer body have a relation to his nerve endings. And when a person is severely burnt, and a person, mathalan, has a third degree burn to the extent that he can't feel the pain, and if it is that it is said that he can no longer feel, then he has burnt, or his nerve endings have disappeared. He has been burnt past his nerve endings. And so how was the Messenger to know that the nerve endings is where the pain, or that is where one feels the pain? Prophet ﷺ, he was given from the verses this verse, كُلَّمَا نَضِجَتْ جُلُودَهُمْ بَدَّلْنَاهُمْ جُلُودًا غَيْرَهَا لِيَذُوقُ الْعَذَابِ. Every time their skin is burnt, Then they are given fresh skin that they may feel and taste the punishment. And it could, يعني, it would have, if it were that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم were not the Messenger of Allah, he would possibly have said, every time their limbs are removed, we replace them with new limbs. But the ayah mentions, every time his skin is burned, he is replaced with new skin, that they may feel and taste the punishment. And that has seen it a clear indication, Ikhwan, of the fact that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم did nothing but convey. And indeed, the book is the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah Azza wa Jal conveyed these ahkam and these rulings and that which is similar to them to nations that came before. Some of them followed and obeyed and were pleasing to their Lord, and some of them disobeyed, and Allah Azza wa Jal informs us of their affair, as occurs, Ikhwan, in that which we heard today. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, that I have not sent a messenger except that he should be obeyed by the leave of Allah. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ إِذْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ جَاءُوكَ فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا اللَّهِ وَاسْتَغْفَرَ لَهُمُ الرَّسُولِ لَوَجَدُوا اللَّهَ تَوَّابًا رَحِيمًا. And if only when they wrung themselves, they would come to you, O Muhammad. They would approach you. And they seek forgiveness for themselves, and the messenger seeks forgiveness for them. And that is one of the verses that the people of Sufia attempt to use to claim that it is permissible to go to the grave of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, when the ayah clearly indicates that it is a reference to that which is at the life, or that which occurred during the lifetime of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam. The address was to the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ إِذْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ جَاءُوكَ, they come to you when they wrong themselves, and they seek forgiveness for themselves, and the messenger seeks forgiveness for them. لَوَجَدُوا اللَّهَ تَوَّابًا رَحِيمًا, they would have found Allah تَوَّابًا رَحِيمًا. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. Allah Azza wa Jal then lays down the principle, by Allah, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ, by your Lord, they will not believe until they make you, O Muhammad, a judge in that which occurs between them. ثُمَّ لَيَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِّمَّا قَضَيْتْ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. And then they don't find any harm in that which you have judged, and they submit with a true submission. That is the attitude, and that is what Allah Azza wa Jal has commanded the believers with. That which Allah Azza wa Jal and His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم have revealed, and that which they have left, that which is left from the Sunnah, and that which Allah Azza wa Jal has revealed upon His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, He has given it to us, Ikhwan, that we may submit to it. For indeed, Islam is present for us to submit to, not that we mold and shape Islam in accordance to our hawa. Rather, we learn Islam, we study Islam, as Abu al-Aliya from the Salaf and others said, ta'allamu al-Islam, learn Islam, and then when you learn it, then don't move from it left or right, remain upon it, learn it and follow. Al-ittiba', that is all that is upon you. There is no need for you to use any major mind skills or any great intellect in utilizing or in following, just follow. And that is what is upon you. And that is a problem that people have had historically, that following is not enough, following is not sufficient, we need a bit more, and then we start to use the aql and the intellect in the text and they go astray. So Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِّمَّا قَضَيْتْ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. They will not believe until they make you, O Muhammad, a judge in the affairs between them, and then not find within themselves any harm in that which you have judged. وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا, and they submit with a true submission. And then Allah Azza wa Jal mentions the affair of those who came before. وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْقُرَىٰ إيش الآية؟ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. وَلَوْ أَنَّا كَتَبْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَنِ اقْتُولُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ أَوْ اِخْرُجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ مَا فَعَلُوهُ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْهُمْ. Allah mentions, if it were the fact, or if it were that we were to write upon them. وَلَوْ أَنَّا كَتَبْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَنِ اقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, that you should kill yourselves, or that you should exit your land. يعني as a recompense and as a punishment for the deeds that you have done, مَا فَعَلُوهُ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِّنْهُمْ, they would not have done it other than قَلِيلٌ مِّنْهُمْ, other than a few of them. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ فَعَلُوا مَا يُعَظُونَ بِهِ لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ وَأَشَدَّ تَثْبِيتًا. But if only they had done what they were admonished to do, if they had carried out, just done it, that which Allah Azza wa Jal had commanded them to do, then it would have been better for them and greater in the establishment of their affairs. That would have been the ideal thing. Just carry it out. Don't question it. Don't cross question it. Carry it out. It is not the creation of any man. Now me and you are going to sit down and argue about it and reason and cross question. The only thing that we need to do is understand that we've understood it correctly. That is the only issue that we should have. Have we understood it correctly? Then we carry it out and we fulfill it. We act upon it. If only they were to do that, لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ وَأَشَدَّ تَثْبِيتًا وَإِذًا لَآتَيْنَاهُمْ مِنْ لَدُنَّا أَجَرًا عَظِيمًا وَلَهَدَيْنَاهُمْ صِرَاطًا مُسْتَقِيمًا. If they had done so, Allah mentions, then we would have given them from ourselves أَجَرًا عَظِيمًا, they would have received a tremendous reward. وَلَهَدَيْنَاهُمْ صِرَاطًا مُسْتَقِيمًا, and we would have guided them to the straight path. They would have received a tremendous reward. Just fulfill, and you would receive that tremendous reward, and you will be guided. But what was their choice? They chose, ayyuhal ikhwa, to follow their aql, to follow desires, to act upon hawa, to listen to hasad, to follow jealousy and envy and rancor and malice. And on the basis of it, they became misguided and they left the path of Allah Azza wa Jal. And that, no doubt, ikhwan, returns back to the importance of giving thanks to that which Allah Azza wa Jal has blessed us with. Allah has blessed us with a deen that is easy, blessed us with hearts that are submissive. And that in and of itself is something that we must give thanks for. As Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in that which we heard tonight, as it relates to shukr, this affair and this issue, if we only fulfill it, then Allah Azza wa Jal will bless us. Giving thanks, ayyuha al-ikhwa, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, is a protection from azab. مَا يَفْعَلُ اللَّهُ بِعَذَابِكُمْ إِن شَكَرْتُمْ وَآمَنْتُمْ. As Allah Azza wa Jal mentions, what will Allah do with punishing you if you believe and you give thanks? Why will Allah want to punish you? Allah says himself, مَا يَفْعَلُ اللَّهُ بِعَذَابِكُمْ إِن شَكَرْتُمْ وَآمَنْتُمْ. What would Allah want with punishing you if you give thanks and you believe? And that necessitates from us learning what it means to give thanks, and what it means, and what iman is with Ahlus Sunnah. And giving thanks, ikhwan, is with the tongue, and is with the limbs, and is with the heart. It is not just lip service. It is something that we manifest. If we give thanks for that which Allah has given us, then we use it in a way that pleases Him. Giving thanks likewise is to profess that, أَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ, that we speak about it, and we mention Allah's blessings, Alhamdulillah, and that we feel nush'ir in our hearts and in our depths of our chests, that we feel thanks and gratitude for that which our Lord and Mawla has given us. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى وفقنا وإياكم لما يحبه ويرضاه. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد.